Very, very fascinating and interesting to hear some of the stories, and I mean, I've been chatting to most. I've also on Facebook, I've seen quite a number of, I mean, Brent and Rene came back. They actually were telling me quite a bit about some of the things that you've been doing. So it's really good to be here. It's a pity that I don't have the time to actually go and individually visit the hubs, but I'm hoping to actually go and do that in the very, very near future. So basically, I think you all should know what RLabs is about. I'll maybe just give you a little brief journey, my version of the journey, compared to Brent or Ines' version, right? So RLabs initially started off as an idea, right? So it started, was probably end of 2007, leading into 2008. Now, when it was started, that's interesting, it was started as a simple idea that was only it was all about doing one thing only. We had a very similar problem, where the problem of substance abuse, drugs, and gang violence was completely destroying our community. You know, and in all our communities, there are things that are destroying our communities. It could be poverty, it could be youth unemployment. I don't know about you, but in South Africa, we have very high youth unemployment. And those are all challenges and things that are causing the communities to feel tension. Right? So the idea was basically birthed around, of course, my background is technology. I was fortunate enough to be at the university for about 10 years. So I started lecturing when I was 12 years old, as you can see. I'm still 22. And basically what happened was, we had a trip to Finland, all places, in Helsinki. It was my first encounter with Helsinki during winter. Now, for those of you haven't, there are quite a few Finns here. But visiting in December is not always the best time to visit, because it's dark, it's gloomy, it's raining. And it was the first place that I've been to where I've never seen the sun. So I was there for 3 days and I didn't see the sun once. But anyway, being there, in the darkness, we were just kind of talking about ideas around what can we do to bring about change in our communities. So at that time, the idea was not about RLabs. It was purely a simple idea to help one person in the community. There wasn't, let's set up a hub or anything big. It was, let's help one person, a person that is basically struggling, a person that is vulnerable, and let's see if I can't use the skills that I have to empower that person. So that one person, to give you an idea, his father started the largest gang in South Africa, and he basically ran what they call the underworld. It means he was part of the gang culture for many years, right? He's a very good friend of Brent's. He was the one that actually invited Brent again. And what basically happened when we started in 2007, RLabs was only a project. Okay, so it was just a computer, right? It was a very, very old computer that was running on dial-up. So you can imagine trying to teach them, and it wasn't teaching them computers, it was all about getting them to share their stories, basically, right? So that started off as a project. From that project, and all we did was, the theme was always about hope, and it was about, reconstruction basically meaning, it's about seeing the community being changed. That's the reason why we do what we do. If any community living lab as such, always has a goal to bring about change in the community. If your goal is not to see change in your community, then it basically becomes a bit worthless doing it. Then you might as well just become another entity that's just kind of doing training. The ultimate goal is to see change or transformation in our communities. So that is where it started, and it was only a project, so there was we called it the reconstructed project. That was what it was, the reconstruction project. No living lab, it was only myself, Eventually we had 14 guys, of which Brent was one of the first group. Most of you have met Brent. So there I was with these 14 guys, and we were basically, I had one motor vehicle, and we had to drive 20 kilometers that I had to go and drop them off where I could at least use computers at one of the local universities. They allowed me to use one of the rooms. So you can imagine having to cart 14 guys for 20 kilometers. Only happened twice a month. So that was basically what we did. So from a project, as things began to grow, you know, we then realized that yes, it started off with 14 people that have been trained, but then more people want to train. I'm sure many of you have had people saying they also want to be trained, but of course the lack of resources is always a big challenge. So the one thing that I've learned is that whenever you find yourself not having enough resources, that is where you have to really be creative, isn't it? So what we did, I basically went and I borrowed people's computers and I set up temporary labs in the community. Now remember, at that time we never had any space. We only were allowed to use one room in an organization called Impact Direct that we were very close to. That's one of our partner organizations. And the other thing that I also did, I also offered people whose computers was broken, I asked them, can I fix their computers for them? Right? And then I can use the computers. So that was basically how we set up our first, how we went from one computer to I think about 6 or 7 computers. And by that time, we then started having programs like, and I'll just quickly write here, maybe in a different color, called MOM 2.0. That's a program for women and for mothers only. Because one of the things that we found in a lot of our communities, women is very important. None of us would have been here if it's not been for women. Right? I think that's a fact. So we started a program specifically for mothers, teaching them about how they can share their experiences with one another. Although it was about technology, the key thing about the women was it was more about them supporting one another. And that was one of the most amazing things. We then also started a program for kids that we call social media for teens. So these were all young kids that came learning about using the internet, and that was another program. So at the end of 2008, it was great, the programs was going, we were all excited, and I thought, that is it, I'm done what I did. So by the end of 2008, I decided that I obviously don't have to do anything else. So when 2009 started, okay, now remember a year, it was only just a project, no name, right? 2009, I got a phone call, people asking me, Marlon, when are we going to start classes again? And I'm like, what are these people talking about classes? Like, you know, because I thought I was done. My plan was to teach one person and get them to learn how to use social media and the internet to share their stories so that other people can read their stories. That was my goal. Right? Managed to do about, I think it was probably about 17 or 19 people in the first year. And that was it. I thought, I'm done. I don't have to do anything. So 2009 starts, and then people ask, what about, aren't we going to start classes again? So what actually happened, it was the community that demanded more. And that is when we decided that people are now actually thinking we're offering training. So we decided, seeing that the people wanted it, we just started doing it. So it was in 2009 when we decided, because things started picking up, we then had about more than 100 people who now are going into training. Again, by this time, the organization decided they're going to give us one room. And the size of the room is literally, if we look at this pillar, right, this pillow here, and smaller than this section over here. It's a very small room. And that is literally became the head office of RLabs. So what we then had to do was, we then registered a what they call an NGO. You also have NGOs there?
Yes.
A formal NGO, because we had to be a legal entity. And also, by this time, we've never received any money. Right? Everything that was done out of our own pockets, or looking at what people had. We were always using what we had available. That's why I love hearing that you're using your company's facilities, looking at what you're using, what you have, the the Nemocrafts, for example, the two computers that you had, and you know, and these kind of things are very good. It's always good to leverage what you already have instead of not starting something because you don't have. That's the worst thing you can do. And that is not what an entrepreneur or a living lab should think about. So we started a formal NGO. By that time, we then registered what we call, if I not take you on that journey, we then put in an academy. And we, because we are based in a place called Athlone, we then gave ourselves the name Athlone Living Lab. You know, we also wanted to have that name. But unfortunately, the big challenge for us was we were not all about just the Athlone community. We're about people in any community that are facing challenges. And that was really what we were about. So we had to come up with a new name. Long story short, eventually we became officially known as RLabs. And RLabs stands for Reconstructed Living Lab. It's basically a living lab that's about transformation, get a board in place, and so forth. But it was also during this time where we realized that the academy was one of our big things, and most of you are running training programs at the moment. But the reality is that the training and the empowerment components that you're doing is not going to be the end of it. People still go and they still face lots of challenges in your community, am I right? There's still going to be people that are going to be unemployed in your community. So one of the things that we realized was that as a living lab, we have the responsibility to come up with new ideas of how we can solve real issues in our community. That was very important. So it was here we began what I would like to think as our true living lab activity. We then started doing living lab activities, and we then started creating new types of innovations. For example, we created the technology at that time to offer counseling support. Actually, we did it in 2008. But by that time, we were running counseling services using mobile phones, where people can ask for help and for support, because that was a big need in the community. Right? And by doing that, we actually began to realize that the same innovation that we are using to do good, perhaps we can also use that same innovation and we can turn it into a business. Very much like some of the activities that you're doing. The one thing that we've learned is that you have to use the value that you have. Because remember, what you are creating, you're creating value in your living labs. And that value, someone has to pay for the value. And in most cases, the people that you are serving can't pay for it, they can't afford it. And the reality is, TANZICT is not gonna, you can't depend on TANZICT to pay for that value either. You have to find a way of turning that value into something that can generate an income. Right? And that's always the biggest challenge. And so what we've done is, and we realized being an NGO, because what does the NGO do? An NGO gets money from a donor or from government organizations, and based on what they have, they then do work, isn't it? If the money stops, what does the NGO do? In most cases, it collapses. So we realized that being an NGO was not the best thing to be. So what we've then done, so remember we did academy training, we did living lab activity, this is now when we started doing things around innovation. Meaning we looked at what are the problems in the community and can we turn those problems into opportunities, you know, those kind of things. Now I don't know about in Tanzania, but in Cape Town where I'm from, we've got lots of problems. Maybe here you don't have any problems, right? Tanzania don't have any problems, right? No problem in Tanzania. It's an amazing place. Sure. No? One, two problems? No? Only one. Okay, only one. Unemployment is a problem. Okay, so other than unemployment, everything is good. Okay. Is there any other problem in Tanzania? Nothing else? Okay, only unemployment. So we realized that in 2009, so we continuously journeyed, but in 2010 something happened for us because we then began to see that there's been a bigger interest in what we are doing. And we realized we can't just be an NGO. Now even though we were an NGO, I want you to remember, For a year, we never got any money. No money. No one gave us money. Over here, we didn't have any big donors or people that gave us money. Right? It only literally happened in 2010. And guess who gave us? It was actually a Finnish program called COFISA that gave us our funding initially. And that came through around the early 2010, late 2009. And what actually happened is here we decided that we have to adopt what we call a hybrid model. Now, you know what the word hybrid means? It means it's like a mixture of two.
Yes.
Right? So you basically do exactly what we heard earlier. It's on the one hand, you do your social activity, like an NGO. On the other side, so on the NGO side, you basically write donor, you write proposals, and you get money in to run some of the programs. But you also have something that you've created that you can sell. So for example, if you're setting up a hub and you have a cafe, you have a donor that maybe sponsors some part of the hub, but the cafe will generate income. So that is basically what we would call a hybrid model. Because the cafe would never be able to sustain everything inside the hub. Right? I mean, in my experience. Some of the work that you're doing, you may be doing training on the one side for free, and you might decide some of the training might for companies might be at an expense. Because that is what RLabs did. In 2010, came to 2010, what RLabs did, we ran the academy. We then also started something called the digital factory. Now just to give you an idea, these components is training. The academy is all training. The digital factory is training to corporates or to other organizations or to businesses, and they pay us. So here we get paid, and that is for free. So if you can see, that is community, and this is basically business. Same training, same stuff. So all of a sudden, we then started doing a little bit of a hybrid model. Okay? But the other thing we did, we then launched an innovation incubator at that time. But what it means that within the context of the community, now for you to understand, where we are based is basically it's in the community, where there's a lot of youth unemployment. I think we've got about 75% youth unemployment. Education levels fluctuates. And for us, there was a lot of challenges in the community. So for us, the innovation incubator was very important. We also then realized that we need to develop a business development arm. In other words, a section in the organization that purely focuses on making money. That's all it was, right? So, and I'll explain, the innovation incubator was basically when we got ideas, turned ideas into reality. Okay. The business development was when people do fundraising, and they try and sell our services and products. Now what, when I talk about products, the products that RLabs created was products that came out of the incubator. At that time, we were creating our own, with the community, doing the own, I mean, RLabs is the community, basically. So immediately, we were focusing on training, on the incubation, and on the business development. And then we also had lots of partnerships. So this is with universities, government, business, and other NGOs, right? So that was basically 2010. So we still continuously kind of doing the what they call the hybrid model. And most of you most probably are going to start moving into the hybrid model as well, very shortly. But the big place to be, the best place to be, as a living lab, is actually, and this is where we are currently venturing into. I'm going to jump to 2030 now. We actually want to become a for-profit social enterprise. we have, for any questions around social enterprise or social entrepreneurship, we have the experts in our room, so you can. but basically the idea is that we want to get to a point, now this is where we are moving towards, where as much as we are doing a lot of good, so the more good we do, the more income should come in. That's basically. Because what's the, all of you mentioned the challenge of resources, didn't you? That's one of the biggest challenges. You can't do more because either it's a human capacity, human capital, you don't have enough people, or alternatively the cost of maybe computers or facilities. And we have the same problem, the same challenges. But the one thing that we've learned is that the more good we do, we should technically be able to generate an income out of the good. And it doesn't mean that the community has to pay for it. So to give you an example, in Cape Town alone, right, we still run the academy. And since that now, we've passed 8,000 people that we've trained since we started in 2007, 2008, right? Of course, what has also happened with RLabs now, we still have a digital factory, which is a business, right? And to give you an idea, that digital factory has generated a lot of income for us in the last 2-3 years. We also run, I'm just giving you a quick overview, we also do what we call social franchising. And of course, many of you are part of that process, where we try and take all that we've learned and we actually replicate the model. We eventually want every living lab that is following the RLab model to be able to run a self-sustainable operation, empowering and transforming communities. That for us is always what it's about. It's always going to be about hope. Everything else is secondary for us. It's always about changing the lives of people. That is what it's fundamentally about. Right? In Cape Town, we employ about 52 people, I think, now. And it's all community members that we employ full time. And we have about, I think, something like 48 volunteers. Now, in that small hub, and remember, we started in one room. We only got our space, maybe I should put that in the timeline, in 2011. That is when we had our own space. Only 2011 we got our space. During that time, we were in one room. Right? We also in, it's now 19 countries. We work with various partners, like the work we do with TANZICT. Right? We're in 19 countries now, we've expanded the work that we are doing from RLabs, with the hope that as we grow together as a network, and you part of that network, that you can also benefit out of our experiences and out of our networks. And the other thing we still do, the incubation. Out of our incubation now, we've launched 14 companies and we sold 3 already. That gave us an average of 10 times our investment. It means if we invested $50,000 in a company, we got 10 times that back out of. So, and that basically started only from 2010 onwards, we were able to launch 14. So every year we do very similar, we take between 6 or 7 ideas, and we take it in a 9-month program. And that is also what we hope that we can do in your communities as well. And then the other thing that we do is we have an investment fund. Investment fund, we do research work, and there's a lot of other stuff that we do. Okay, I'm not going to go into all of that. But the key thing, if you want to know about what we've learned in this entire journey, that whatever we do is always comes back to people. That without people, we can't be a living lab, right? And it always has to be open to everybody. This year, to give you an idea, in our academy, 70-75% of everybody there. So we do an average of just over 1,000 people a year, or women, right? We, in our incubator, 50% of the business ideas are women, and we're getting there. We do a lot of work with vulnerable people, people that have been involved in prostitution. Even, basically, we work with the people that nobody else wants to work with. But those are the people that we work with, and we love working with them, because they are very creative naturally. And it doesn't mean we only have to find people that, I'm just saying, those are the contexts that we were in. And in the end of it, the key thing about RLabs is this, basically. It's about hope. It's about innovation. Right? It's about empowering people, which is very important. And also, it's about having lots of fun. A living lab shouldn't be work. You must never feel like work. It's always about creating an environment where people feel this way they want to be. And that is really what we've created. So I think I'm just going to quickly stop there, and I'll go down to maybe talk about challenges. I'm just going to follow your routine. So I think our biggest challenge has always been in Cape Town. The main hub has always been space. So we're trying to find bigger space, because we always run out of space. But our big challenge has been, most probably, we need to continuously try and build more human capital, because we are outgrowing our capacity. So that is why we are constantly trying to employ more people, because we're just running out of, and that takes time, getting people into that frame of mind. And I think some of the living labs have shared that similar experiences already. That's the other big challenge. So, and that is something else that you're always going to have to learn. You always need to make sure that you build capacity. Meaning, you need to actually develop someone that can take your place. That is the goal. You should never be the one that controls everything. Someone must come and take your place, and try and make sure that it's someone that you can train up. And the person don't have to be the best. I mean, I'm not the best. I'm actually the worst. Everybody else in the office is better than me. But the one thing that I've learned is that don't wait for the best. Take someone that's got the heart and who's got the commitment, and you train and develop them. And that's something that's very, very important. Most of the people, to give you an idea, 90% of our full-time staff, right, before last year, has not completed school. I think when Brent was here, Brent didn't complete school yet. You know that, eh? You know Brent that was here. Brent didn't finish school. He was a school dropout. And we came back and we finished school. It was good. Exactly those are the kind. So you don't need to have, there's nothing wrong with university degrees, right? So don't get me wrong. I'm just saying, for most of us in the community, we just need people that's willing to do things. Right? And not asking for money to do it. That's the other thing. Find the people that's willing to do it, even if there's no money involved. Because that is how most of our people stop. They first volunteer, and then we take them on to stop. It's only occasionally when you need a certain expertise, like someone that is an accountant, or someone that can do certain things that will pay the bills. But other than that, most of the people come from the community. And that's something that you need to do. You need to develop the people on the ground. And then, I think one big success story, it was probably me being able to stand here and see you. For me, that's a big success. I'm extremely happy to see what you've done. And it's bearing in mind when we started this whole journey, it was a crazy idea in darkness in Finland. You know, I don't want to chase you away from not going to Finland. Please do go. It's a lovely place, right? But that has really been, for me, the big success, to see the stuff that you are doing. And it kind of makes my heart like leap for joy. So I don't think there's maybe quickly time for any questions, or any specific things that I might have missed, or things that you just want to know a little bit more about. I think I have 2 minutes to answer that.